Hey, and welcome back to Faye at Five. I'm LaTangela Faye, your hostess, and you know, it does my heart well to have those in the hot seat and on the tan line that's doing some amazing things in the capital city and surrounding areas and representing around the globe. Now, listen, he's no stranger to the madhouse. I'm just grateful that he decided to come back. I want to just put this disclaimer out here right now. This is not a part of my work release program. However, if I ever had that one collect call, it's me. I'm going to make the call to none other than B. David Quinn. How are you?
Absolutely great. Thanks for having me.
Anytime. And thank you for making another trip to the Madhouse. I know you have been super busy. A lot of things are going on. You're into the next season. You know, TV One, they got it right. They say, we need more. And we're here for it. You know, ATL Homicide. How does it feel to be back for another season?
Oh, it feels amazing. We got through the taping. We had to do a little mini bubble down in Tennessee to get it done over last summer. We shopped everything and had it in the can by like January. They trotted us on out. Season three. Let's do this.
Let's do it. You know, let's just rewind this thing. Okay, so TV One got it right with ATL Homicide, talking about true crime, the stories, even some of it that's in hindsight, and just reliving the actual case, unfolding the case. Now, with that, you have to relive every single experience that you've been through, and I can't imagine how tough that has to be in itself.
Yeah, it is kind of tough, but at the same time, it's a blessing. You know, we get to, you know, see these young cats reenact these cases that we worked in our 30s. We're brothers approaching our 60s, and we're humbled to see what was going on. I mean, the families have always been the tie that binds. That's the reason why we do it, the families left behind.
Absolutely. And you and your partner, Vince Velasquez, y'all have been click tight for so many years. And it's just like you can see that chemistry, not only on screen, but just while you're both putting your brains together to figure these cases out. You know, like, how important is it that you have the right partner to walk through the process and get all of this done while you're solving these cases?
A man you can actually trust. This is a guy, he's the 3 o'clock in the morning on both sides. I mean, this is my brother. I love this cat. And for us to get an opportunity, the first show of his kind, a true crime show depicting a black and brown brother. I mean, how good is that? I mean, I've never seen that. And so you see our connection with the community, and then you see our lasting connections with the families of those left behind.
You know, you mentioned the community, and oftentimes when the community see a cop roll up, we're really not trying to talk. You know, community policing and the patrolling and the relationships. Now, do you think that it's more difficult, especially in the world that we're living in, the climate that we're in with social media and so many things coming to the forefront a lot sooner? Some of the stuff you used to can hide, but now with the policing and the relationship with the cops in the community, do you feel that there's a major disconnect?
Okay, LaTangela, there is a disconnect. I mean, with the very necessary civil unrest last summer, we had to get some things corrected in the society in which we live. Right. Our culture was put out there in a bad way. It's now the onus is on the police departments to go back into these neighborhoods, win one street, one neighborhood at a time. It's not impossible. I remember, I've been working so long in this game, I remember the Rodney King verdict uprising. I was out there that night, and we got through that. But cops got to go back in there. You know our people, black and brown, if we think you're real, we're going to be about you, and we're going to definitely support you. So they got to go back in the street, get out them cars, and love on these citizens. Let's start over.
Yeah, we have to start over. Because where we are right now, it's like, you can put out all the helplines you want. You know, the community itself has this no snitch policy because snitches get stitches. And that has been deep in our culture for quite some time. But you see the crime that's riddling through. And it's like, I don't want to see a BTR homicide that needs to spend all from the ATL homicide. But in all actuality, TV One that may need to bring it down here so you can figure it out too, because every single day it gets harder for me to do my job. You know, I'm starting to see more youngsters with this gunplay, more family circles that are being broken and reporting the news. I either know who did it or who it happened to. And it's really tough. And now you're starting to become so desensitized to it because it's just another number. And no one is saying it's another family member, it's another son, it's another daughter, mother, father, and it's hard. It's really, really hard.
Well, the one thing we have to do, LaTangela, is to recognize and accept that we have our own pandemic within the culture, and that is gun violence, like you mentioned. Yeah. I mean, and none of us can escape it. We're all, none of us are absolved or protected, you know, from it coming to visit our home. Just last October, during the height of the pandemic, my son, who 26 years old, just come home from the military, leaving a friend's house, gets gunned down by two people. This is my baby boy. Right. And, you know, I'm running out to the scene. You know, I got the call from a 911 call, and it took his phone off him as he lays there bleeding. And I get out there, people think I'm coming to work the case. It impacts us all.
Right.
By the grace of God, three bullets that hit my son, he survived. Amen. And, you know, he's battling back. But that is our own personal epidemic. It's our pandemic, and we got to address it. We have an issue. Let's get these armed career criminals off the street. And let's make sure we don't take our communities and just wipe them out as we try to eradicate these armed career felons. You can do both. You can love on the people in the community and take out the bad actors at the same time. You can do both.
Exactly. You know, and our prayers are definitely with you and your family. I know that is an uphill battle, and it has to be some type of a feeling, you know, to know that you've dedicated your life, your work to fighting these crimes and to attempt to make the community a better place, to have it really land directly on your doorstep, and not with catching a bullet yourself, but with your heart outside of your body, you know, your son, you know, so I can't imagine how that must have felt, knowing you've dedicated your life to this, to now having to work the case on a completely different level.
And I'm gonna give it to you the real, the police department, it's a Metro Atlanta Police Department, they were horrible. And I had to scream on them. They literally, I don't know if they were intimidated by me, the crowd, when I got out there behind the yellow tape, you know, everybody's like, Quinn, you here to work the case? I said, no, that's my seed down there on the ground, people. Right. You know, the police played me. So I had, you know, they didn't give me the kind of service, because police departments have a history and they have a bad reputation when it comes to working cases on Black males that survive gun violence.
Wow.
You know, you're put off to the side, well, that's a disorderly conduct. No, that's an aggravated assault. Mm-hmm. And one of our loved ones has been mortally wounded and probably going to be affected for the rest of his life. I had to go to the chief and you know, make my complaints. And I urge all of our people, Black and brown, get out here. And if you're not getting the right answers, everybody got a boss. Don't tell them they can't, you know, either give you the police service that you required or need through your tax dollar. But they got to give you the empathy. They got to give you the sympathy, everything else that comes with it. Yeah. Families are victims too.
Absolutely. You know what? That's major. And here at Fayette 5, we really like to open the door and keep the line of communication open. You know, I want everybody to feel warm, welcome, and invited and free to speak their piece, right? And this is Absolutely. A platform where we need to hold people accountable, hold ourselves accountable with our actions, hold people on every single platform accountable, because even as you walk your course on whatever job it is, that's your platform. So however you treat people, that's a reflection of who you are and the brandship that you have with whomever you're working with. And you know, you'll get these people with these titles. Sometimes they forget that you're here to protect and serve. So I shouldn't be afraid to talk to you. And that's why I really love watching you guys on the show. You've always been about the community. And with ATL Homicide, it gives us the inside scoop and behind the scene coverage as of how you will put people in a taxi cab so they can come down to the precinct to talk to you. Because no, I don't want to be seen in the hood snitching, because that's just what it is.
So you got to protect your constituency.
Right.
People in the street know that that's your constituency. Take care of them.
Yeah. Have you ever had a case that just stood out to you the most, that just would never leave? You couldn't shake it, or you couldn't solve it, or it just hit too close to even put your mind around?
You know, I got to say the last case I worked as an active detective back in 2014 involved, you know, a young man that went out here killing our homeless citizens. Our homeless brothers were getting gunned down in their sleep as they lay conspicuously on the sidewalk. Because that's what homeless people in Atlanta, they sleep on the sidewalk because that's their protection. And there was some sinister individual out here systematically going around and shooting them dead where they sleep. That thing haunted me. It was 15 days of pure hell trying to figure out what happened there. And you got to have luck and you got to have some God. All your efforts don't mean anything without that. And within 15 days, I was able to bring that thing in. The brother confessed. And it was just my first look at evil. This was evil that made no sense. Hundreds of murders I worked had to deal with a lick or some jealousy or revenge.
Retaliation, maybe.
Retaliation. This was just some I want you dead stuff. And he and the brother told me he was getting gratification out of it. He admitted it to me. And it was spooky. And on my way out the door, you know, I never had a serial killer in all my years of working. I've helped out on some. This was mine. Right. And this guy needed, when we did the interview and the interrogation, when I was, you know, trying to get him to tell the truth, this joker fell in love with me. He asked me, he wished I was his father.
Wow.
So the catharsis of everything surrounding that, it was spooky. It was eerie. I couldn't even write the paperwork up on it because it was a homicide that affected me to this day. Because I really never stared in the belly or the face of evil. It was the evil that's out there.
I can't even imagine, you know, like, how do you even deal with that and say at home, I'm going to turn this off. When 5 o'clock comes, I'm done with this case. I'm going to play golf or whatever your day-to-day activity, however you decompress. How does that not follow you 24/7? Because that just shook me like, wait, what?
Yeah. So I married this lady 30 years ago.
Uh-huh.
And she's also a retired police officer. So what? She keeps the brother in check. You know, we got 6 kids up in here. She's like, you know, get yourself together. We got to keep it moving.
Yeah.
Cause I didn't golf. I didn't fish. I didn't have any hobbies. I did murder and I did the family. Cause we had so much going on in here. We're down to 1 left. We raised raised 5. We got a junior just started school this week. And that's so, what I'm saying is things were so busy. Everybody just knew their discipline. I didn't want a hobby because my hobby was serving these people on these homicides where I spent the vast majority of my career. Yeah. But I got a tough wife.
That's
and,
good.
A tough mate can keep you straight.
That's
and,
it.
And you got to have your spirituality. You better believe in something because you can't carry this type of evil, these horrible stories that happen to families without a spiritual center. Mm-hmm. So I thank my God for getting me through that.
That's right. And delivering you the right one. Keep you grounded. Hey, look, David Quinn, don't you forget to take that trash out. And when you get back, I'll feed you.
and fold these clothes. We got, you know, we got 8 bodies, you know, making clothing every week. And you got to, you know, help out with the watch. So I did all that.
That's awesome.
And so that kept me straight.
I love it. You know, for this upcoming season, we're in full effect right now. What should we expect on TV1 with ATL Homicide?
Well, LaTangela, every year it gets a little better.
Okay.
The actors are now us personified. They have become the real David Quinn and Vince Velasquez, our actors, Angelo Diaz and Chris Diaz.
Yes.
The rhythm, the tone that they have on screen is amazing. I think you'll also see in these stories, we'll have examples this season of the community and the families actually participating and helping and solve the cases, which is something I've never seen.
Right.
Yeah, we'll deputize an auntie, an uncle, a girlfriend, whoever. We want you in because everybody's a detective. We're all figuring something out in our heads every day. Yeah. Use those skills practically in helping solve your loved one's murder. You'll see a lot of that this year.
I'm super excited about it. You know, none other than Vince Velasquez and David Quinn on the scene, ATL Homicide, TV1. I'm going to tell you at 7:30 so you don't be late. It really comes on 8 o'clock Central, 9 o'clock Eastern. But listen, get that 7:30 because you don't want to miss it. TV1, I just want to say thank you for bringing it back. I am a fan first and a friend always. You know,
always.
This is an open door policy. So whenever you have anything going on, feel free to jump on this tan line. Because you're stuck with me forever, ever, forever.
I'm gonna be hitting you up. And I'm working on a book right now. This is the lab right here you see behind me.
I see
when
you.
When I'm finished with that, I want to come on and talk about that.
Listen, if I don't get that interview, I'm going to be upset and I cry in public.
Hey, I'll cry with you because I'm emotional now. I've let those evil bags off me. I'm here.
I'm super excited for it, and I'm proud of you. You know what? Send my love to the family, and I'll see you soon.
No doubt. Love you, sister. Thanks for having me.
I love you more, and there's absolutely nothing you can do about it.
All right. Okay.
So I want you to chase the sun or let the sun chase you. But either way, get after it.